Good evening. Thank you very much for joining us here on Mirror Now. I'm Hina Gambhir. My idea this evening is to begin the show with showing to the viewers this particular note, this note, and a coin. Because till today, chalo kuch khareed le or let's go and buy with cash used to involve coins and currency notes. Now, these are not ordinary items. These have the weight of the sovereign and the guarantee of the Reserve Bank of India. They are called as the legal tenders, but soon, cash and the coin may actually get a third player. Not physical, but digital. We may not be able to touch it or put it in our wallets or in our pockets or purses, but can spend it like coins and notes, and that will have full RBI backing. Well, in last few months, you all must have heard about the storm over the cryptocurrencies, the virtual avenues promising the glitz and glamour of higher returns. Some of you, in fact, must have invested in them too. But there is a problem. They are not regulated by the RBI or simply bound by no regulations. Hence, they lack any legal backing. And tomorrow, if they crash, and here I'm talking about cryptocurrencies, government or RBI can actually not do much about it because it can't really do anything to bring your money back. And this probably gave the RBI this idea that people are open to this idea of digital currency, which is official and regulated by the RBI. Today, officially, the Ministry of Finance has informed the Parliament that RBI, in the month of October, in fact, had sent a proposal for amendment of the RBI Act 1934. And that is a very, very important piece of information because here the RBI has asked the government to enhance the scope of the definition of banknote. RBI wants the word currency in digital form included in its definition. And this, viewers, it is a step closer to India getting its own digital currency. What exactly is it? Why is it coming? How will it work? And Mirror Now's mantra is how something will impact the common man, you, the viewer. So let's find out how this will really change our life from our eminent guests who are joining us this evening. These are the big questions that we will be tracking for you. How will this digital currency really work? And joining us on the broadcast this evening to help us decode this new term, digital currency, that is soon going to be a part of our lives. Subhash Chandra Garg, who is former finance secretary. We also have with us Aruna Sharma, former member digitization committee. Thank you very much, both of you. Good evening for joining us here on Mirror Now. Mr. Garg, I want to begin this discussion with you. You know, in last so many months, we've heard about this term cryptocurrency, but suddenly today, the Ministry of Finance informed the Parliament that RBI wants digital currency to be included in the definition of a bank note. What does it mean?
See, number one, I don't think this should overexcite us. The 2019 bill, which was prepared by the finance ministry, also proposed to issue the digital rupee, which was the digital currency. There are two ways to do it. Either you can bring a new separate law which can define the digital currency and set out the mode of its issuance by RBI or otherwise, or you amend the RBI Act, which provides for the banknotes to be issued. The current proposal seems to be, which is what came out in the parliament today, that the RBI prefers that the banknote definition in the RBI Act should be expanded to include the digital currency, which is fine. That's the way to go it. Second, by the way, Indians are getting used to, and they have got used to, digital payments for quite some time now. What you make payment by way of UPI or otherwise, using your money in your bank account by means of IMPS or RTGS, NEFT, etc. This is also digital payments. And they have also been for quite some time the digital wallets available for small payments in the country. So what the new proposal or the whenever the digital currency comes into being in the country would do is that the currency itself, rather than using the money in your bank account, can be used to make, can become part of the digital wallets, and you can make use of it. So that's what, in essence, the proposal is.
Okay, so that's the proposal. But Ms. Aruna Sharma, I want to understand from you, for the benefit of our viewers, in simple terms, if we have to decode a digital currency, RBI-backed digital currency for our viewers, then will it be the third form of money? As in, you know, I've got this 500 rupee note in my hand. So this is one form. The coin that I have in my hand of 10 rupees, it's another form. So digital currency will be the third form. So, for example, if I'm getting my salary in my bank account, I withdraw from ATM as, you know, notes. Will it be a separate component? How will it be? How will it change my life? How will it change the life of the viewers?
See, in India, we have already graduated quite a lot on digital payment. You are no longer going to ATM and drawing the cash notes out of it and doing your purchases. You are making digital payments, whether it is through your mobile or through your wallet, as has been rightly said. And this is what is doing. So the difference which will come in digital currency is the printing of the notes will completely go for a change. And instead of having a bank account, you can have this digital currency in your wallet itself. So that is the difference it will come. But your payment mode is going to be the digital payment, as you are doing now. And tomorrow, if you still want some cash in hand, you can draw that cash in hand through your ATMs. And the denomination of the notes will then slowly start coming down. So we may not have 2,000 rupee note needed. Because all payments, all big payments, anyway, are shifting to RTGS or NIFT and everything, and that is what will go.
Okay.
The difference is the digital currency is something issued by RBI, which is completely backed by the gold or by the government, by the stocks that the RBI has got. So it is not something which is fluctuable, and your 100 rupees will continue to remain 100 rupees. It will not become 110 or it will not become 90. The difference with the crypto, and therefore I always insist in all platforms not to use the word currency along with crypto. Crypto is speculative. So crypto is like putting in the securities market, which may double up, which may crash, which you may lose. So the whole idea is for people to understand the difference between the two. The digital currency issued by the central bank backed, that is RBI backed in India, vis-a-vis the crypto, which is a speculative, which you will be using it like any security is, which you are doing in a share market. So where you may gain, you may lose. So the investor has to be aware of.
Okay, that's a very important point that you're making, Ms. Aruna. And I want to go across to Mr. S.C. Garg as well on this point. So it is not an alternate really to cryptocurrency that RBI is offering us. That's a different story altogether. We'll have to wait for the bill to come out to know what is happening to those coins, the crypto coins, as they are always shown as. This is another form of currency that we'll be getting. Will it be more safer, sir? Because coins and notes can be looted.
See, as you have rightly noted and also Aruna pointed out, this is the third form of the currency. We have metallic coins, currency, gold, silver, bronze, and other kind of coins which have been circulating. The rupee, which is the physical notes, so the fiat currency. And now the time has come for the digital currency to arrive in the world because a lot of transactions in the economy are becoming digital, in the bank systems, even purchases, e-commerce, elsewhere. So the time has come to have the digital form of currency. As far as the safety is concerned, you see, there have been challenges in the fiat currencies which could be counterfeited, faked, and laundered. So those challenges were there in the physical system as well. Likewise, the digital currencies can probably be hacked. There can be others. So the risk would always remain. But whenever the central bank or the government builds up the system of currencies, it takes up and makes enough security arrangements, etc. And despite that, something would be there. And also, I don't believe that whenever the digital currency would be issued or introduced in the country on a in an overnight or in a very short time, there would be a complete transformation from physical currencies to the digital currencies. It will gradually get introduced. In fact, there are two big models which are being experimented all over the world. One is the wholesale form of the digital currency, and the second is the retail. If we don't know at this point what the RBI is considering, is it coming out with only for the wholesale, big payments kind of thing, or is it also venturing into the smaller payments, the retail payments? There are also technological issues. Whether you use the cryptography, blockchain kind of technology to do it, and there again, there are different modes, whether it's permission, non-permission, or you use the dematerialized kind of thing like securities. So a lot is not even known today. What I think is the government is going to do is to introduce an enabling provision if it is done as per the RBI suggestion by amending the RBI Act. That enabling provision will allow the RBI to sort of design the currency, and if it is to be done in the digital form, it will have a lot of architectural and other issues as well. So it's not coming out any day soon. It will take time and gradually work its way as a currency in the system.
सिंपल टर्म्स में कहिए, पब्लिक का पैसा सेफ होगा अगर डिजिटल करेंसी आ जाती है, बिकॉज एवरी टाइम इट इज़ अबाउट डिजिटल ट्रांजैक्शंस विद द काइंड ऑफ यू नो फियर्स एंड द काइंड ऑफ रिपोर्ट्स दैट वी हैव गॉट फ्रॉम अराउंड द वर्ल्ड, देयर इज अ बिट ऑफ अ कंसर्न. नॉट एवरीबॉडी इज कंफर्टेबल. मिस्टर गर्ग,
चीज तो है, देखिए जो फर्क है वो ये है, इन सिंपल टर्म्स आज जैसे आप कैश में ट्रांजेक्शन्स करते हैं तो देयर इज नो ट्रेल. एक ने पैसा दिया, 100 रुपए का नोट किसी दूसरे को दे दिया, यू डोंट हैव एनी ट्रेल. इन डिजिटल ट्रांजेक्शन्स यू हैव द कंप्लीट ट्रेल. दैट हैज द एडवांटेजेस बिकॉज यू कैन फाइंड आउट कि वेयर वाज द लॉन्ड्रिंग डन और द हैकिंग वाज डन. बट इट ऑल्सो हैज द डिसएडवांटेज दैट यू लूज योर प्राइवेसी व्हेन यू मेक ट्रांजेक्शन्स इफ यू डोंट वॉन्ट द सिस्टम टू नो अबाउट दैट ट्रांजेक्शन. सो दैट इज लॉस्ट. But in terms of safety and because of the audit trail which becomes available, I think it's relatively more safer to have the digital mode of currency rather than physical.
Okay. Now, Ms. Aruna Sharma, I want to understand from you, one of the advantage, it seems, is that we are going to slowly move towards being a cashless society because this is going to increase our dependence on digital transactions. Already, India is moving towards the digital space because I was looking at some data. UPI transactions, in fact, in last 3-4 years have risen by about 70 times. So we are slowly moving there. But do you think when people don't want to know where they are sending money, then probably this will lead to an increase in transactions via cash?
No, because there will be a complete trail and digital currency will exactly operate from A to B. So you will know that A is sending money to B and B will know that A is sending money to B. So it is not unknown. It is exactly like RTGS NIF, what you are used to today, or IMPS you are used to today. So it's not like a curtained wall where you will not know it. You will know it in the digital currency, number one. Number two, no country targets for a cashless. It is less cash society. So in the sense, the cash transaction will start coming down. And even though the UPI transactions has been increasing since we made NIF RTGS 24/7 and IMPS and reduce the rates of commission on the MDR and everything, there is still a lot of cash floating in the market. It's nearly to a tune of 25 lakh crores of rupees, which has jumped up quite a lot. So all that will reduce when we are moving, and a lot of bulk transaction will move into this. And as there is a complete trail of the money, the taxation and other things will become much more simplified, much more easy, and which will take care of money laundering. The only fear will be the cybersecurity measures. And here I would like to make it that China is the first country which has gone in for a digital currency, but they are still working on the complete architecture. They have not completely rolled out. It's a lot of architecture is being worked on into this, and only then it will be proceeding on it. So digital currency, only one country has come forward, China, which has declared it. Others are still working upon it. So it's a work in progress and it will require a complete architecture change. But this is something the future which is going to happen, if not very soon, not very far as well.
Okay, but Mr. Garg, are we ready for this kind of a ecosystem which will have digital currency? Because cash, you know, is easily accessible. To use digital currency, one will definitely require either a computer, a laptop, or at least a smartphone.
See, we already are doing lots of digital payments. In terms of value, about 95% of the payments in the country are happening digitally today. I don't know why we forget when we discuss about anything which is happening on the digital currency space. It's a different matter that in terms of physical transactions, the volume of transactions, still 80-85% of the transactions are in the form of cash. That is what, since we see it all around us, that is why we still feel that we are there is too much of cash transaction in the economy. When the currency becomes digital, the currency transactions which happen in cash today would also become digital. And this will help us in progressing towards more digital transactions, and the digital transactions, the smaller amounts. So, as I said earlier, it's not going to happen. It's a very sort of design intensive, the process intensive. And as you also noted, not many people, still more than 30-40% people don't have smartphones. And very few people use the internet or the computer systems. So something which becomes so easy, digital cannot become that easy for everyone to use. Old, new, infirm, child, many of them. So I think it will take years before even we can see about 50% of the currency transaction happening in the digital forms. So it's a long way. I don't think we should be getting over carried away by this phenomenon, but this is a right direction to go.
Okay, it is a right direction that India is taking at this point in time. Mr. S.C. Garg, stay on with us. Ms. Aruna Sharma, I want to also understand from you, as you mentioned about China, and along those lines, India has also now begin to think that it can experiment with a digital legal tender. What could be the challenges, according to you, that the RBI should really keep in mind? Because, of course, there is this cryptocurrency ecosystem which already exists. Then we have Paytm transactions. We have UPI transactions. I mean, you know, already there's too much out there in the market.
See, let me tell you, there is a difference between digital currency and digital payment system. So what you are talking about, the NIFT, the RTGS, the Paytms, all through, which is going through the UPI transaction, these are the payment mode. That will continue. The payment modes will continue. The currency will change, right? So you will have a digital currency backing it up, instead of your bank account backing it up.
So then will this then require a different bank account for each one of us?
Yes. So the entire way the banking system is working, it is not a different bank account. The way the banking system is working is going to make a difference, right? So that is what is the real difference. So like anyway, with the digital payments, the physical bank requirements is slowly coming down and many of the branches are closing in the urban areas. However, the need for financial inclusion for a brick and mortar bank is needed. So when we go and penetrate inside the country in that 5-kilometer radius, you need a financial institute. So whether it's a post office or cooperative bank or a bank, that will be needed. So let us not say ki A is replacing B, but it's a new technology that is coming. That is number one. Digital payment system is different from digital currency. That is number two. And the entire architecture is getting built up on it. Even there is a sandbox which is being worked on where digital payments can happen on the feature phones, that is non-smartphones. So that is also under development. So all this technology is going to work. And this is a blockchain-based technology where the entire trail of the money can be easily tracked. And that is where the major transformation is going to happen in the way the RBI prints its notes, prints its currency, and India is much ahead in the digital payment mode vis-a-vis the other countries. So therefore, we have that advantage on this shift. But then, yes, it's a blockchain technology which will be adopted to track to keep the records of the transactions as it is moving. It will help in money laundering. It will help in tracking the money. If it is going into the wrong hands or getting encashed for the wrong hands, all that is going to make a difference. But yes, we have to also tighten the cybersecurity measures as we are moving ahead into it. So this is the graph on which it is going to go. And this enabling provision will trigger the action towards it. So the blockchain technology will start. And crypto, again, I repeat, is entirely a different ballgame. So crypto will what is being talked about is the regulator. And regulation is very important for the crypto because the KYC model has to come there. They must know who is investing and who is tracking the money. The second is that it has to be 100% blockchain. There has been some instances where some transactions were kept into internal database, and that is wrong. So it is very important the regulation should flag it when you are forming a regulation for the crypto. And similarly, the regulation should come up of the strict compliance for the AML and educating people that this is a speculative investment. It is an alternate investment mode. It is not digital currency of RBI. It is only because the way currency is used there, a lot of confusion is created in the market. So it is crypto and this is digital currency. The two are entirely different things. Two are entirely different enactments on which it will work. So RBI correction of allowing the digital mode will be the digital currency, the official digital currency of India. And El Salvador is the only country which has given crypto the legal tender status. India and rest of the world has said a capital no to it. Crypto will never get a legal tender status as far as India is concerned. It will only be a speculative investment for people to put as you put your money in the shares or as you put the money into your any other speculative market. So it will be in the portfolio of your investments, whether you are investing in the crypto. So that is the model which should be very clear in the mind. And two will be, the crypto will be regulated by a different norms, different directions of the government, and digital currency, that enabling amendments to the RBI work schedule of currency, it will make a difference.
I think you very nicely explained to our viewers, Ms. Aruna Sharma, the basic differences that are there between crypto and a digital currency. And I would like to just add one more, that while the value of crypto, which is also called as cryptocurrency today, keeps on changing, keeps on fluctuating depending upon demand and supply. On the other hand, as far as this digital currency is concerned, its value is going to remain as it is, just like the value of our rupee or the notes that we have. Last question, I would like to go across to Mr. S.C. Garg for that. So, we are being told that RBI, the Reserve Bank of India, is expected to start the pilot project in December. What really can be expected? Because you explained to us that, you know, it's still a long process. It's going to take time. It's not that overnight things are going to change. We are not going to really see an 8 November 2016 kind of a moment anytime soon. But what can we really now expect from here on?
So let us see first what kind of bill the government introduces. The bill is still not ready. It has not been discussed by the cabinet. Intimation has been given to the parliament that this will be introduced, but we don't know. Only after we come to know of what exactly is contained in that bill, then one can think of what the potential roadmap would be. In my judgment, since the subject is so complex and mixed up with this entirely new system of crypto, blockchain technology-based services, assets, and many other things coming up, including, by the way, there is now in the world, there is very large component of what we know as stable coins. So, and they are linked to dollars. So today you can get literally digital dollar or e-dollars by sort of buying USDT. And in the buying, Bitcoin has received lots of news and attention. But what today a lot of people are buying and remittances are coming through is the USDT, Tether and all. So how those... its interface with the international transfers would also be dealt with. Those issues can only be seen and sort of upon once the bill is there. So I don't think we are at this stage to say or lay down a roadmap of how things will work out over next.
But we'll have to closely monitor what really happens in the winter session of Parliament, because both these things are going to be very, very important. Thank you very much, Ms. Aruna Sharma and Mr. S. Seegar. Appreciate both of you for joining us here on this special show on Mirror Now.